Somebody lift your worship all over this room.
The God of miracles, signs and wonders. We believe in your power. We believe in your power. For the God of miracles,
signs and wonders.
We believe
in your power.
Lord, we
believe. Signs and wonders.
We believe.
This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us be glad and rejoice in it. I was glad when they said unto me, Let us go into the house of the Lord, for God has shown thee what is good. And what does the Lord require of thee but to do justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with our God? Good morning. We welcome you this morning to the Andrew Rankin Memorial Chapel. And we pray God's blessings upon you as we seek to worship our God in spirit and in truth. We are indeed blessed to have as our preacher the Right Reverend Michael B. Curry, the first African American to be elected presiding bishop of the Episcopal Church. Bishop Curry has proven himself to be a leader of leaders. We welcome him back to Howard University and to the Andrew Rankin Memorial Chapel. Pray for him as he comes to bring us a word from the Lord.
Thank you. This week's scripture comes from Isaiah chapter 40, verses 21 through 31. And it reads, "Have you not known? Have you not heard? Has it not been told you from the beginning? Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth? It is God who sits above the circle of the earth and its inhabitants like grasshoppers, who stretches out the heavens like a curtain and spreads them like a tent to live in, who brings princes to naught and makes the rulers of the earth as nothing. Scarcely are they planted, scarcely sown, scarcely has their stem taken root in the earth when God blows upon them, and they wither, and the tempest carries them off like stubble. To whom then will you compare me? Or who is my equal?" says the Holy One. "Lift up your eyes on high and see. Who created these? God who brings out their host and numbers them, calling them all by name. Because God is great in strength, mighty in power, not one is missing. Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel, 'My way is hidden from the Lord, and my right disregarded by my God'? Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. God does not grow faint or grow weary. God's understanding is unsearchable. God gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
I can do this. It can be true, and I can stand up. I can make it through. I'll be all right. So I've been told, if I only take your hand and don't let go, I'll be stronger and cry no longer, and I'll never wander from your love no more. Now, not like before. If I only take your hand and don't let go, I can be the one I'm intended, the one I can go beyond every circumstance when down on my knees, when I'm down on my knees. I see my way now, now that I found who knows how, and he cares to show, and he'll protect me from all that I don't know. If I only take his hand, can stand. If I only take his hand, I can conquer anything. Lord, I simply take, I'll take your hand. Please don't don't let go. Don't let go. I'm counting on you.
Let us prepare our hearts and our minds for prayer. Let us be still before our God. Most gracious and loving God, you have said that if we would just talk to you, if we open up our hearts to you, if we just tell you what we need, you will answer. We confess, O God, that we are not certain of what we need. We confess that too often we listen to what others think about us, what others want from us, and not what we want for ourselves. Our need to be liked by everyone is often stronger than our need to like ourselves. We seldom take the time to listen to the cries and yearnings of our own hearts, or to pursue the desires that you have placed there. Give to us, O God. Give to us whatever we need to listen to our hearts, to trust what our hearts are trying to tell us, to listen for what brings us joy, what brings us contentment, and what brings us peace. And while we're trying to figure all of this out, help us to be more patient and more gentle with ourselves. And help us to be more patient and understanding to those around us. We humbly ask for forgiveness, Lord, especially from all who have been hurt by our sins, our weaknesses, and our insecurities. And then, O God, help us to be grateful for what you have already provided. May our gratitude and compassion motivate us to serve and to seek justice for our hurting humanity. Oh God, you know our every need and our every desire. Bless us, Lord. Heal us, Lord. Bring us through this terrible pandemic. Bring comfort to all who are grieving the loss of someone they have loved. And even beyond this pandemic, our nation needs your healing. Let your love, let your justice, and let your mercy immunize us against the hatred, the racism, and the greed that has made this nation so sick. Heal us, Lord. Hold us now. Hold us in your love until we learn how to love. And in your name we pray. Amen.
Well, Lord, I'm tired and so weary, but I must go along till the Lord comes and calls me away. Oh, yes, where the morning is bright and the land. The night is as fair as the day. Oh, yes. Oh, there'll be peace in the valley for me someday. There'll be peace in the valley.
Indeed is a privilege and a pleasure always to be with the Howard University community family, the Rankin Chapel service, and particularly to be with my friend, brother, and colleague, Dean Richardson. I wish that we could be physically present or present in a more embodied way, but that shall come again. As the Jewish tradition says, in the feast of the Passover next year in Jerusalem, maybe next year at Howard. I also want to thank Dean Richardson for his remarkable sermon preached at the Washington National Cathedral just a few weeks ago. I listened to it and was moved by it and blessed by it, as you have been blessed by his ministry these many years. Thank you, my brother. And thank you, my brothers and sisters. Allow me, if you will, in light not only of Black History Month, but more significantly in light of where we are as a nation and as a world, to offer what I think and hope and pray are some words of hope and where it comes from. For text, let me offer the words of Hebrews chapter 10, verses 32 through 38. Recall those earlier days when, after you had been enlightened, you endured a hard struggle with sufferings, sometimes being publicly exposed to abuse and persecution, and sometimes being partners with those so treated. For you had compassion on those who were in prison, and you cheerfully accepted the plundering of your own possessions, knowing that you yourselves possessed something better and more lasting. Do not, therefore, abandon that confidence of yours. It brings great reward, for you need endurance, so that when you have done the will of God, you may receive what was promised. For yet, in a little while, the one who is coming will come, and he will not delay. But until then, my righteous shall live by faith. Keep the faith. Keep the faith when you feel it, and keep it when you don't. Keep the faith when you understand and comprehend it, and keep it when you don't. Keep it when all is right with the world, God is in his heaven and all is right with the world, and keep it when nothing seems to go right. Keep it on mountaintop of exaltation, and keep it in valley of humiliation. In any and all circumstance, in life and death, joy and sadness, moments of belief and moments of doubt, just keep the faith. Because the God in whom that faith is entrusted, even when you can't, he will keep the faith in you. And that faith will carry you. When I was a few weeks ago, actually, I was on a Zoom conference with a number of Native American and Indigenous leaders in our church, some on the Navajo reservation, some on the Sioux reservation, and a number scattered in different reservations and communities in urban communities on the north and northwest, even up to Alaska. And in the course of the conversation, at one point the question emerged, how do you make it through a time of pandemic? How do you make it when there is weeping and a wailing in the land? How do you make it when death is real and constant? And a neighbor. How do you make it when the pandemic of a virus isn't the only pandemic in our midst? How do you make it when George Floyd, representative of Emmett Till and Michael Brown and Eric Garner and Breonna Taylor, how do you make it when we watch his life snuffed out by another human being, an officer of public safety? How do you make it? When this has been going on so long, you want to cry out like the psalmist, how long, oh Lord, how long? How do you make it when in this country, the capital of the United States is besieged by white supremacists, white Christian nationalists, anti-Semites, neo-Nazis, Klansmen? How do you make it when that happens in this country? And we asked, how I didn't make it. And these native leaders, one of them said something like, well, our people have made it. Our land was taken from us. Our land was ripped from us. We marched the trail of tears, and many of us died. We were the victims of genocide here in America. We were butchered and killed. People named football teams and baseball teams after us to mock us as if we were not human. And yet, we are still here because there is a spirit greater than our human spirit. There is a great spirit. There is God. And we keep faith. My grandmother came to mind as they were talking. And I remembered her granddaughter of slaves, daughter of sharecroppers in North Carolina. I remembered her having buried members of her family over the years, children born in stillbirth, others sent off to war, family members who didn't come back from war, folk buked and scorn, talked about, sure as you're born, as the old spiritual says. And yet, I remember the many songs that she loved, one of which I think is wisdom for our time, that says it this way: oh, for a faith that will not shrink, though pressed by many a foe, that will not totter at the brink of any earthly woe. Oh, for a faith that will not shrink, though pressed by many a foe, that will not totter at the brink of any earthly woe. I remembered what the ancestors taught us. You keep the faith. You keep the faith in the God who will keep the faith in you. You keep the faith whether you understand it, whether you don't, whether you are on the mountaintop of exaltation or the valley of humiliation, whether you rejoice when Barack Obama becomes president of the United States, or you weep when the capital of the United States is breached by Nazis. Klansmen, keep the faith, because if you keep the faith, that faith will keep you, and you'll keep on keeping on. That's where our text is helpful. Listen to it again, for in a little while, the one who is coming will come, and he will not delay. But until then, my righteous ones, my just ones, my ones who work and labor for peace, my ones who work and labor that all human beings are treated as children of God, my ones who work for equal and civil rights for all of God's children, my ones who work and labor for a day when our young men, black and brown, will not be beaten up by officers of public safety, my ones, where there will be a world and a country where every man, woman, and child may sit under his own vine and fig tree, my ones who work for voting rights, my ones who work for a decent world for all of God's children, my ones, until he comes, they will live by faith. But those words precede Hebrews chapter 11. And chapter 11 helps you understand where that's coming from. Chapter 11 begins with the words, faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. And then chapter 11 gives us some examples of people who kept the faith. It talks about Noah, who kept the faith, who believed God when he said it was going to rain, but believed him and trusted in him while the sun was still shining. And folks said he was crazy. That's sort of like Harriet Tubman, when she used to come into the neighborhood and said, the freedom train is coming. Follow me and go to the land. And some folk just couldn't believe because they couldn't see it. But other folk got on that freedom train, and over 300 people were led to freedom by Harriet Tubman in her Underground Railroad. No, that's like Noah. Faith is about believing and trusting in God's promises and working for a new world, even when you can't see it. It's building an ark, even while the sun is still shining. And so they mentioned Noah. But then they mentioned, oh, Abraham and Sarah. And Abraham and Sarah, you will remember, they were from Ur of the Chaldees. But God said to Abraham and Sarah, Abraham and Sarah, I know that you all are in your 90s. You are up in age. But I want you to leave your home and your family and that everything you know in the Ur of the Chaldees in Babylonia. I want you to leave there, and I want you to go to a land that you do not know, to a people that you do not know, and there I will make of you a great nation, even though you are in your 90s. I will make of you a great nation. And they did. But then God tested them some more. God met with Abraham and said, Abraham, Sarah's going to have a baby. And the Bible says when God was talking to Abraham, Sarah was eavesdropping at the tent. And it says, Sarah, when she heard God say that she's going to have a baby, Sarah laughed. Now, I used to think when I was young that the reason Sarah laughed was because she knew she couldn't have children, and she was now in her 90s, and she knew that wasn't going to happen. But the older you get, the wiser you get. You begin to understand there may be some other dynamics in the story. And the truth is, I got a feeling the reason Sarah laughed wasn't because of Sarah. The reason Sarah laughed was because she knew Abraham. And she knew that wasn't going to happen. And yet, Sarah had a baby. And yet, Hagar, Sarah's maid, had a baby. And because of the miracles of God, in spite of the odds, in spite of it all, in his old age, Abraham became the ancestor of Jews, Christians, and Muslims. Keep the faith. Keep the faith whether you feel it or whether you don't. Keep the faith whether you can see it or whether you don't. Oh, and then it goes through even more lists. It talks about Moses. Moses who was in exile. And God said, go down, Moses, way down in Egypt land. And you just tell old Pharaoh, let my people go. But Moses said, this is the Pharaoh of all Egypt. He is the superpower of our time. He's got an army. He's got a navy. He's got military might. He's got money. And I've got nothing. And God said, but I will be with you. And the record shows that Moses led Hebrew slaves out of their bondage in Egypt after a long and protracted civil rights struggle, but he led them to freedom. Keep the faith. Keep the faith when you feel like it and when you don't, when the odds are against you and when the odds are for you. Dr. King said it this way, the moral arc of the universe is long, but it is bent toward justice. Keep the faith. Work on, love on, believe in the end. Love is going to win. Keep the faith. And after going through this list, and there are many more that I could name, the writer says these are people who were persecuted and beaten down. They lived against the odds because they believed that God's love and God's justice and God's compassion would endure. And yet, in spite of it all, they kept the faith. And then when you get to chapter 12, the writer says, now, therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us run with perseverance the race that is before us, looking to who? Looking to Jesus, who is the pioneer and the perfecter of our faith, who for the sake of the joy that was before him endured the cross, despised the shame, and now sits at the right hand of the throne of God. Keep the faith. Because keeping that faith, Jesus said, love is the way, and love can make it happen. Keep the faith, because Jesus said, compassion is the way, and compassion can make it happen. Keep the faith, Jesus said, blessed are the poor and the poor in spirit. Blessed are the merciful, the compassionate. Blessed are the humble, the meek. Blessed are those who work for peace. Blessed are those who work and labor for God's justice. Love your enemies. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who despitefully use you. Follow me, and I will make you more than you ever dreamed that you could be. Keep the faith as Jesus kept the faith, even when they nailed him to a cross, even when his mama watched him die. Keep the faith, because love is gonna win. Keep the faith. Because the source of love is God. Keep the faith, because nothing can stop God's love. St. Paul said it this way, I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, not things present, not things to come, not height, not depth, not anything else in all of God's grand and glorious creation shall ever be able to separate us from the love of God in Jesus Christ. Keep the faith. Jesus kept the faith even when he cried, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? He kept the faith even when he said, woman, behold your son, behold your mother. Even when he breathed his last and said, Father, in the moment of death, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. And he dropped his head and died. In that moment, stay with me. In that moment, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. He's quoting Psalm 31. In fact, all of the seven last words that we remember on Good Friday, every one of them comes from the Psalms of David, with the exception of woman, behold your son. All the rest are quotes from the Psalms. And the Psalms, if you know anything, they were the hymn book, if you will, of Israel. It was as if Jesus from the cross was quoting and singing the hymns. Oh, for a faith that will not shrink, though pressed by many a foe, that will not totter at the brink of any earthly woe. Even in death, he kept the faith. And the God in whom that faith was kept on the third day caused the earth to quake, caused the stone to roll away, and raised Jesus from the dead. Love is stronger than hate. Goodness is stronger than evil. Because God is God. And nothing and no one else is. My grandma liked another song that said it this way. I was sinking deep in sin, far from the distant shore, very deeply stained within, sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry. From the waters he lifted me, now safe and I. And then the folk would sing, oh, love lifted me. Love lifted me when nothing else would help. Love lifted me. Our faith is in the God who the Bible, 1 John chapter 4 says, beloved, let us love one another because love is of God, and those who love are born of God and know God. Why? Because God is love, and nothing can stop God. Nothing can stop love. In the end, love is going to win. In the end, justice will roll down like a mighty stream. In the end, God's love, God's will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And if you trust that, you can keep on working in the spirit of love for justice, compassion, and goodness, and decency. some years ago. And with this, I would conclude. I was pastor of a parish in Lincoln Heights, Ohio, which is a small all-black town just outside of Cincinnati. This was in the 1980s. And while there, we heard that this preacher was coming to speak at Ohio University, Ohio State. And so a group of us got together from our church and some other churches in the community, and we drove by caravan from the outskirts of Cincinnati, little north to Columbus. Preacher's name was Desmond Tutu. This was the early 1980s. I can't remember if he had won the Nobel Peace Prize at that time or not. But this was certainly before apartheid had fallen. In fact, this was during the period of time when we as a country were debating whether constructive engagement or a boycott of South Africa was the way forward. This was during the time when Nelson Mandela was still in prison with no hope of freedom. This was the time when open rebellion was happening, attempting to strike a blow for freedom, and blood was flowing in the streets. This was the time when funerals of young men who were freedom fighters, when their funerals became moments of protest and witness. This was a time when South Africa did not know whether it wouldn't matter whether you were black, white, or colored. It would simply be the flow of blood through the streets of the city of Johannesburg and other cities. South Africa might degenerate into a civil war. This was a time when hope of a multiracial democracy, of the rainbow children of God, all God's children, when that seemed like a faint hope, a fond dream, a long, long way off. And it was at that time, that moment, that Desmond Tutu spoke. And I don't remember the whole of the sermon, but I remember how he ended it. He ended it saying, "I believe that one day my beloved South Africa will be free. I believe that she will be free for all of her children, black and white, brown and colored, Asian, Indian. I believe that one day my beloved South Africa will be free for all of her children. I believe it not because I can see it, but I believe it because I believe in God. I believe in the God who raised Jesus from the dead. I believe in the God who my Bible says is love, and nothing, nothing can stop God or God's love." Oh, my friends, the ancestors were right. The Native American ancestors were right. There is a great spirit. There is a great God Almighty, as my grandma used to say. Keep faith in that God. Keep faith in the God of Jesus of Nazareth. Keep faith in his love and his way of love. Keep faith until there is a new heaven and a new earth. Keep faith until there is a new creation. Keep faith into God's, until God's kingdom comes, until God's will is done on earth as it is in heaven. Oh, for a faith that will not shrink, though pressed by many a foe, that will not totter at the brink of any earthly woe. This year, 2021, keep the faith. God love you. God bless you. May God hold us all in those almighty hands of love. Amen. Thank you.
with a man who would lay down his life for a friend. Oh, there is no greater love than a man who would lay down.
There is no greater love. Wasn't that a dynamic message? Though the physical doors of the chapel are closed, the chapel remains open and vibrant as we continue to support the entire Howard University community. And we need your financial contributions. To support the ministry of the chapel, please visit our website, chapel.howard.edu. There you will find a give link. And during this time of uncertainty, never forget the power and presence of prayer. You may submit prayer requests via the chapel website as well. We are excited to invite our student organizations to submit calls to chapel via the chapel website. Please share your exciting events and programs. Join the Office of the Dean of the Chapel for the Wellness Collective, an experience for the mind, body, spirit, and soul, featuring experts in mindfulness, meditation, psychology, self-care, and spiritual care. Beginning February 15th, this virtual interactive series will take place bi-weekly. Also, join us tomorrow at 8 p.m. for another installment of our Communal Conversation series. For this Black History Month edition, we will be highlighting Black service organizations, and our students will be discussing the significance of serving our community and what it means to be a leader at a historically Black college and university. Communal Conversations can be viewed live on Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube. To stay updated on all things chapel, follow us on social media, Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook with the handle at Howard U Chapel. Take a moment now, subscribe to our YouTube page, and like us on Facebook. Lastly, please share your worship experience with us using the hashtag SundaysRForChapel. We now welcome Dean Richardson, who will lead us in our benediction.
We thank you, Bishop Curry, for that very powerful and timely message. Let us now prepare our hearts and minds for the benediction. We thank you, O God, for what our eyes have seen, our ears have heard, and our hearts have felt. And now I said to the one who stood at the gate, give me a light that I may go out into the darkness and into the unknown. And she replied to me, go out into the darkness, go out into the unknown, but put your hand in the hand of God, and God shall be for you better than light and much safer than a known way. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and give you peace, both now and forevermore. Amen.